Leia here from leiaforsci.com, and in this video, we're going to look at Markovnikov versus anti-Markovnikov when it comes to alkene addition reactions. When working on your alkene addition reactions, if you have a perfectly symmetrical alkene and you subject it to a reaction like hydrohalogenation, reacting with HBr, I have an option of putting the hydrogen on bromine on either of the two carbons for that pi bond. If we call this carbon 2 and carbon 3, and draw out the two products where the hydrogen is on 2 and bromine on 3, and then reverse it, you'll notice that this is actually the same exact product. Drawing the second one backwards is redundant because when I name it, I'm forced to number it from the side that gives bromine the lower number for a product of 2-bromobutane. Given that we have symmetry in the molecule, it didn't matter where I put the bromine. But what happens if I try to do the same reaction with an asymmetrical starting alkene, where in this case, the pi bond sits between carbons 2 and 3, where carbon 2 is a tertiary carbon and 3 is a secondary carbon. If I carry out the same reaction, first breaking the pi bond, and then adding hydrogen and bromine, for the first product, I'll add hydrogen to carbon 2 and bromine to carbon 3. For the second, we'll put bromine on 2 and hydrogen on 3. Remember that in skeletal structure, hydrogens are invisible, so all we're left with is bromine sitting on carbons 2 or 3. Now we have two completely different products. The first one is 2-bromo-3-methylbutane. The second is 2-bromo-2-methylbutane. Very different molecules, so the question is, which is the correct product? And this is where Markovnikov's rule comes in. Markovnikov discovered that when you have hydrohalogenation of an asymmetrical starting alkene, such as this one, where the pi bond sits between a tertiary and secondary carbon, we're going to get two different products, but one of them will be favored. The product is going to favor the molecule that has the halogen on the more substituted carbon rather than the halogen on the less substituted carbon, making 2-bromo-2-methylbutane our major product, and this one here, the minor product. But this rule can be expanded to all the alkene addition reactions, where we say a molecule that follows Markovnikov's rule is one where the substituent adds to the more substituted carbon, specifically of the two carbons that used to form the alkene. And a reaction that goes anti-Markovnikov is one where the substituent adds to the less substituted carbon of the two that used to form the alkene. Anytime you learn a rule, you're looking for a quick way to remember and apply it. But here's the warning. If you memorize without understanding, you might get confused and mess it up later. So let me show you the shortcuts, and then let's explain why Markovnikov's rule is that way. So if you're faced with something complicated, like a halohydrogen formation, you'll still be able to figure out how to follow Markovnikov's rule. The first way to memorize this is to recognize that the nucleophile adds to the more substituted carbon. In the case of hydrohalogenation, the intermediate has a bromide ion in solution, that would be the nucleophile, and if choosing between a secondary and a tertiary carbon, we know it's going to add tertiary. Another way to remember this, even though it's backwards, it does work, is that hydrogen adds to the less substituted carbon. When looking at this same molecule, knowing that the nucleophile has to add to the tertiary carbon, the leftover hydrogen is going to add to the less substituted or secondary carbon. The reason some students prefer this option is the nucleophile changes and sometimes is hard to recognize, but if you know you have a hydrogen, it doesn't matter what it's attached to, you know where to put the hydrogen. Shortcut 3 is actually what I learned back in undergrad, and it's simply another version of shortcut number 2, and that is to remember the quote that the rich get richer, but specifically we're talking about the hydrogen rich get hydrogen richer. If we look at this same starting alkene, even though it's written in skeletal structure where the hydrogens are invisible, you have to remember that a tertiary carbon with a pi bond has a total of 4 bonds. 1, 2, 3, and 4. That means it has no hydrogen atoms. It's hydrogen poor. But a secondary carbon with a pi bond only has 3 bonds to carbon. That means there is a 4th bond to hydrogen. And so this is the only carbon that is hydrogen rich, and therefore it gets hydrogen richer, meaning the hydrogen adds to the less substituted carbon. This is more obvious when your asymmetrical alkene is between a secondary and a primary carbon, because the secondary carbon has one hydrogen and three bonds to carbon. The primary only has one sigma and one pi bond to carbon and two bonds to hydrogen. If we look at the hydrogen rich gets hydrogen richer, the primary or less substituted carbon has two hydrogen atoms, the secondary or more substituted carbon only has one hydrogen atom, therefore the hydrogen rich gets hydrogen richer. If you're finding this video helpful so far, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and let's continue. Now if you're thinking, Leia, these are all great, which one should I memorize? This is what I recommend. Not a single one. These are great if you're looking to pull it off quickly, but if you don't understand what you're looking at, you're going to have a hard time applying this to tricky questions. So let's sidetrack from this conversation and make sure that we understand what Markovnikov's rule is actually all about, so that no matter how it's presented, you know how to tackle the problem. The principles for Markovnikov's rule goes back to a very simple phenomenon in organic chemistry, in any science, and in life. Something happy will be very stable and unreactive. If it's unhappy, it will be unstable and therefore very, very reactive. Let's take this concept a step further and apply it to the mechanism of this reaction. As I teach in the hydrohalogenation video, the first step in this reaction is the nucleophilic pi electrons on the alkene are going to reach out for and grab that hydrogen atom. Hydrogen can only have one bond, so when it's grabbed and a new bond forms between itself and carbon, the electrons between hydrogen and bromine have to collapse, break away from hydrogen, and onto bromine. We have two potential intermediates for this reaction. With a pi bond initially between carbons 2 and 3, I have the option of placing hydrogen on carbon number 2 or on carbon number 3, where the other carbon that used to hold the pi bond is now missing a bond, it's deficient, giving us a positive charge or a carbocation. This is the key. This right here is what helps you determine the direction for Markovnikov's rule. Carbocation stability. That's the key. As I teach in the carbocation stability tutorial link below, the more substituted the carbocation, the more stable it's going to be. That means a tertiary carbocation is going to be much more stable than a secondary carbocation, which is much more stable than a primary carbocation. For this intermediate, we're faced between a secondary carbocation and a tertiary carbocation. What is it about the more stable carbocation that tells us which product is going to form? It's a kinetics thing, a reaction speed. Reactions are only as fast as their slowest step. The alkene is relatively stable, and when it attacks that hydrogen, it forms an unstable intermediate. Yes, the tertiary carbocation is more stable than the secondary, but that's simply the lesser of two evils and an unstable intermediate. Therefore, the more stable the intermediate that is going to form, the more likely it's going to form, the faster it's going to form. If an intermediate has to form that is not stable, it's going to be very, very slow, and it may or may not form. So if we're looking at a reaction where we can have some secondary and some tertiary forming, the tertiary are going to form at such a faster rate compared to secondary that if we compare the amount of product, we're going to have a lot more that resulted from that tertiary intermediate. The last step in this reaction is where the nucleophile attacks the carbocation. But the nucleophile doesn't attack the more substituted carbon because it wants to. The nucleophile is greedy. It's negative. It's looking for a positive charge, and wherever that positive charge happens to be, that's where it's going to attack. The fact that the tertiary carbocation formed so much faster means that there are so many more tertiary carbocations available to attack, and all the bromines in solution are rushing to attack whatever they can, that is why we get so many more of this product. So if we had to summarize Markovnikov's rule again, then we can say Markovnikov's rule tells us that the nucleophile adds to the carbon that would have formed the most stable carbocation. If you need to hear this again, rewind the video, listen to the explanation, make sure it clicks, and then let's try a few problems to make sure you really get it. Say you're given a simple alkene reaction where H2SO4 reacts with propene. You recognize that H2SO4 is simply a source of H+ in solution, and that this reaction is going to proceed by a carbocation intermediate. You look at your starting molecule, you identify that the pi bond sits between a primary carbon and a secondary carbon, and you know that Markovnikov's rule says the nucleophile, in this case the OH, is going to add to the carbon that would have formed the most stable carbocation intermediate. You know to put the alcohol at the secondary carbon. What about a situation where you have a carbocation rearrangement? How does that follow Markovnikov's rule? Say we're given this molecule where a pi bond is sitting between a primary and a secondary carbon, but we also have a tertiary carbon nearby. If we're told to react this with the same reagent, H2SO4, in the presence of H2O, we once again look for where the most stable carbocation would have formed. Our first thought is to put the carbocation on the secondary carbon, but here's another trick that you need to remember. Anytime you have a secondary carbocation near a tertiary carbon, you're going to get a hydride shift. If you're not familiar with this concept, make sure you watch the tutorial linked below. That will show you how the carbocation winds up at the tertiary carbon. And then, by the time the water, the nucleophile, is looking to attack, it doesn't care where it attacks. It simply goes to where the carbocation is. And that gives us an unexpected product where the alcohol sits on the most substituted carbon. If you blindly followed the memorization from before and simply looked for what's more or less substituted without taking into account the carbocation intermediate, you would likely have put your alcohol here and gotten the incorrect product. What about a reaction that doesn't follow Markovnikov's rule? How do we use what we now understand to answer products that are anti-Markovnikov? Once again, I want to remind you, Markovnikov's rule was discovered for reactions that have a carbocation intermediate, but ultimately it was about stability. With anti-Markovnikov products, we still want to look at what is the most stable intermediate. Two reactions that may come to mind will be the hydroboration of an alkene, where we react the pi bond with BH3, THF, NaOH, and H2O2, or radical halogenation, where we react the alkene with HX, in this case HBr and peroxides. These both give us anti-Markovnikov products, but not because we don't have a carbocation intermediate, but rather because of what we do have in the intermediate. For hydroboration, the intermediate has both the boron and the hydrogen binding to the alkene, as demonstrated in the hydroboration mechanism linked below, to give us an intermediate that's quite bulky. So when the pi bond has to line up with the boron and the hydrogen, it's less hindered when the less substituted carbon lines up with the bulk of the boron and everything it's attached to, and the more substituted carbon lines up with a tiny hydrogen. This is why alcohol ultimately winds up on the less substituted carbon. Again, the mechanism is shown in the video link below. With the radical halogenation of alkenes, once again, we take the intermediate into consideration. The step that ultimately breaks the alkene is one in which a radical halogen is going to attack the alkene, forcing the alkene to break apart in homolytic cleavage, where one electron goes to each side, giving us an intermediate that has the halogen on a less substituted carbon and a radical sitting on the more substituted carbon. And this is key. Radicals, like carbocations, are more stable when they're more substituted. Because the bromine is the thing that added first, it had to add somewhere that would allow the resulting radical to be on a more substituted and more stable carbon. And in the final step, when a hydrogen is added, the hydrogen just adds as a by the way, because that is the only spot. But bromine has already added the less substituted carbon due to forming the most stable intermediate. In both of these situations, Anti-Markovnikov has nothing to do with the carbocation intermediate, but it has everything to do with the most stable possible intermediate. And finally, how do you figure out Markovnikov's rule? When the two things that we're adding are different, but there's no hydrogen, for example, in halohydrogen formation, where we'll react Cl2 in the presence of H2O. We know that this reaction follows Markovnikov's rule, but there's no carbocation intermediate, and there's no hydrogen to add to the carbon chain. Once again, it's the intermediate that tells us what to do. As you work through the mechanism, which I teach in the Alkene Reaction series link below, we have an intermediate that forms a chloronium bridge. That's a chlorine atom bound to both of the carbons that used to hold the pi bond, only one lone pair, and a positive charge. Chlorine, being a highly electronegative atom, is not very happy with a positive charge and pulls on the electron density between itself and the carbon atoms, making the carbon atoms partially positive. In an asymmetrical carbon, they're not equally partially positive. The less substituted carbon that would form a less stable carbocation holds less of the positive charge. The more substituted carbon that would have formed a more stable carbocation is going to hold more of the positive charge. So when water shows up in the next step, looking to attack something positive, it's more attracted to the more partially positive carbon, which happens to be the more substituted carbon, telling us that in this case, Markovnikov's rule has to do with water attacking the more substituted carbon, breaking this bond between carbon and chlorine, meaning chlorine gets stuck on the less substituted carbon, not because that's where it wants to go, but rather because it was holding on to both carbons and water kicked it out. The final halohydrin now has a halogen on the less substituted carbon because that's where it got bumped to, and an alcohol on the more substituted carbon because it attacked the more partially positive carbon, again, following Markovnikov's rule. I realize this was a lot to take in, so make sure you go through it slowly and carefully. And once you understand this, I want you to go back to the entire alkene reaction series, mechanism by mechanism, and make sure you can apply what you learned here to the individual reactions. Once you feel confident with alkene reactions, make sure you try the Alkene Reaction Practice Quiz on my website, where you can find this entire series and the Alkene Reactions cheat sheet by visiting leahforsci.com/alkenereactions. Again, that's leahforsci.com/alkenereactions.